Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Welcome again to this segment of the Oregon Voters Digest. I'm Bruce Broussard, your host. I hope you enjoyed your sunny day today in Portland, Oregon. We're live here today, and we're going to have quite a show. And normally when I tend to open up the show, I always tend to try to remind you about the vets. Thanks for serving, you know what I mean, this country. And for those who are still serving, again, thanks for serving and whatever. And for those who are not serving, who are in need, if you will, of medical care or anything of that nature, and you have served, whether it be in the foreign wars or the like, or I'm saying. So the thing is that it's a very serious situation. So, yeah, I got my thought going on for a minute, but Howard, no problem. This is community television. I got Howard Williams here with me here today, and right up front with you, there was an issue that I brought up in the last show through Joe Walsh, who's a former Navy guy. And he was a shop steward at one point in time, and we were talking about the whole issue of police shooting at that point at Moynihan Avenue area, and that just the fact that we didn't have enough time to talk about I thought it would be a good an opportunity to talk about solutions. I mean, after the shooting just occurred, and the young man who was shot by a Portland police officer was buried this past week, and but anyway, the issue is still on the table. And but what we're going to be talking about is that we're going to be talking about maybe some solutions, if you will, and in regards to law enforcement. We're going to do it that way. And I just I probably have one of the top shop stewards in the world. He's sitting right here, right with me. And this is Howard Williamson. He was a former with UPS. In fact, he still is probably. So you're probably still getting up in the morning thinking about it, don't you?
UPS retired.
UPS, oh, retired?
After 36 long years.
Okay. But anyway, we're going to know a little bit more about Howard, but we're going to talk about unionism. We're going to talk about union. As you know, Portland Police is a union. It is. They are a union. What is the makeup of a union? What's their policy? How do they go about doing business, if you will? From all levels, okay, with that. Howard, how you doing?
I am doing well.
Great.
It's good to be back on the show again.
Are you enjoying retirement?
I am 1 year into my retirement. I am still trying to get my retirement legs. 36 years of being on a brown truck. It's labor of love, and you gotta love it. I miss my drivers. I miss my customers. I don't miss the work. But what should I say? It's nice to look at a UPS truck now and smile and laugh. And that's what I'm doing.
I like it. And by the way, folks, the next half hour, we're going to do another that segment. We're going to talk with Cynthia Harris. She's very, very much involved in a lot of issues. There's an upcoming conference, if you will, on the 22nd of this month. Talking about mental health and firearms, things of that nature. So she's going to be on our second half hour of the show. And then another lady that's going to be on with us, a young lady that her son was killed in a gang violence type deal. So she'll be on with Cynthia Harris and myself. So with that, we're going to go on. Stick around with us. That's the following 30 minutes. So we're going to just take the opportunity now to sit down here and talk to Howard. And we want to really just get down in this deal. Okay, you got a police union there, and get his opinion and his feelings about that whole thing. How do you define a union?
Well, basically, the reason that you have a union, workers come together, and they want to create a situation of fairness, and that's why people come together. I mean, they see things that they don't like in a particular workplace, and folks come together, and you come together with your core workers basically to create a situation of fairness within the workplace. Mm-hmm. And of course, it's about wages and benefits and working conditions. But over and above those three items, the reason you have a union is protection and for fairness. Mm-hmm. And it's to create a situation and rules of conduct for the employer and the employee. In the case of the police department, i.e., you've got the city, the police chief, and you have the rank and file police officers.
Okay.
And that's how. And they're no different than any other union.
Is it really that? But you know, on a perception basis, though, Howard, you know, you get in a shoot. I mean, we're in a crisis right now. We got a mayor of the city of Portland. He's supposed to be the leadership for the city of Portland. But the perception is that when something happens with reference to police, it's as if to say the police tends to run the city. In that process, and what I mean by that, let's say in this particular case of the shooting, the idea is that. What happens is that there's a shooting, then it goes to the grand jury, then the police comes to the vote and has to communicate and talk to that issue. But at the end of that day, after it comes out of the grand jury, I mean, the person is not guilty or exonerated or whatever. You know, my point is that it's over, but it's not over.
No, it's never over. I mean, you have public employees, and they're public servants. And my heart goes out to the mother that just lost a son. My heart goes out to anyone that has, you know, lost their lives because of interaction with the police department. My heart goes out not only to the families of those who have been killed, but my heart goes out to those police officers have to make that decision.
Yes.
To do what they do. We have a police department where the only thing that I've seen more dysfunctional than the Portland Police Bureau are probably the Kardashians. We have a system that there are things that need to be talked about. They need to be addressed. I applaud every group, every individual, every organization that's about being in the streets and behind closed doors, who are about trying to make positive change. Mm-hmm. There are elements in the police department who are trying to do that. I have a little background in policing. I have two family members who wear blue. I have a nephew who worked in Richmond, California. 3 times Officer of the Year, 4 times nominated at Officer of the Year. Took a housing project, 154 homicides, reduced it to 0. And how many times did my nephew fire his weapon? 0. Zero.
Wow.
That should be the goal. That should always be the goal.
Well, jumping right on in it. Why was that?
It happened, my nephew was committed to community policing. Everybody in that community knew him. Even all the, I went on several ride-alongs with him. I was an organizer for the International Brotherhood of Teamsters. Mm-hmm. And every 5 to 10 days, I was on leave from UPS. And because of my collective bargaining agreement, I was allowed to go work for the union. Mm-hmm. And I spent about almost 5 years running around the country, organizing workers all over the place. Mm-hmm. Spent time with my nephew, and I was able to be there when he got his first recognition as Officer of the Year. And that was given to him by the NAACP. And the one thing about my nephew, and the one thing that should be about every police officer, when I did ride-alongs with my nephew, everybody knew him. When they had a situation where there was a gang tragedy, someone got killed, and there were funerals, my nephew was there. All the different gang members.
At the funeral, everything, the whole nine, in uniform.
Yeah, he went there because my nephew had a strong sense of community. He didn't see someone that was killed as a gang member or a bad person. He saw that as a child. I actually literally watched him cry over killings. Mm. I saw him have to talk to some of the mothers and parents, you know, because when you lose, there's nothing worse than losing a child.
Nothing worse than that.
And he embraced all elements of the community. When the kids saw him, when old people saw him, when businessmen saw him, he was either Officer Michael or Officer Mike. Mm-hmm. And when he left, I mean, it was sad because the way he left, there should be a way that you introduce officers to a community, i.e., you have an officer in the community, that officer should be at an NAACP meeting. Mm-hmm. He should be at the church. Mm-hmm. He needs
that
to be,
turf.
That church. Churches, whatever.
Church,
he should be a fabric.
Turf,
and you know, shouldn't be seen as a threat to a community, but part and parcel of it. And when my nephew departed with Richmond, he is still saddened, and I'm saddened by it to this day. When he left, you know, people weren't told. And he still goes back to his stomping grounds, and he's still part of that community, still involved with the Richmond Police Department, because he still has people in the neighborhood that call him up when stuff happens.
But you know what I'm hearing also from you also, Howard, is that he liked the job.
He loved the job. I mean, just like I love throwing packages.
Right. And he loved the job.
Yes, and I have another friend that worked for the Oakland Police Department. Mm-hmm. We're talking about two of the highest crime areas in the country. Mm-hmm. And one of my high school classmates, Leroy Robinson, he worked for the Oakland Police Department. Mm-hmm. He put in 27 years, never fired his weapon. Mm-hmm. And the reason I keep talking about this and hammering on it, you know, there are ways to defuse situations, and we have to look for ways to stop what's been happening in Portland, Oregon.
Now, let me throw something out to you on the table. You mentioned those individuals that you knew.
Yes.
They were committed. They liked what they were doing.
Yes.
And what comes to mind, and I'll be right up front, the person that comes to mind right off the bat is Harry Jackson.
Oh.
He was a guy.
Friend of mine.
You understand what I'm saying? Harry knew people. Okay. But naturally, he was from the area, so to speak. But the bottom line, he knew people. And I remember him so well because at one point in time, as far as their specs or whatever, their qualification for getting in there, he was too short and whatever. And I remember Bernard Plummer and like yourself, we basically went out there and he got on the force. The man, he was the only guy that I knew that could ride in that car by himself. And he could talk to anybody. He never fired his weapon.
Right.
Right? You got me?
Yes.
And he knew the kids, the whole nine yards, and I'm even thinking about PAL, the police athletic league during that particular time. Harry never had any problems.
Well, if you want to talk about Harry, you got to talk about Harry and his sister, Marcy.
Yes. Yeah, Marcy. Well, yeah. Marcy got on because of Harry.
Yes. Well.
And his son, too, basically. Yes. Is she still on?
Son's still on. And the point being made, I mean, you have to love doing what you're doing.
Yes. That's
and Harry
important.
Was an example of what my nephew
locally.
Was all about.
Yeah.
Everybody knew him.
Yeah.
You know, he used to... Willie Harris that used to have the House of Sounds and the Sportsman Barbershop Charles Befford that has Going Street Market. Mm-hmm. Harry Jackson was a fixture in there. There were several other officers that would take their time and come in, interact with kids, interact with the community. People knew him.
Yeah.
And that's, for me.
Well, the Warrens were good, too.
Yes,
I mean,
I
remember the Warrens, remember?
Exactly.
And they all got in about the same time aspect of it. And you know what I'm saying? So that was a very interesting piece.
Most definitely.
Yes. So again, let's talk about this passion for the work aspect of it. And then that's community policing. I mean, the idea of knowing your area. I mean,
well, it's your community, and you want to take care of it. Everybody should take care of it. You want to take care of the community. Mm-hmm. All the police officer is another component of your community.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? They just happen to have a badge, and they are supposed to be the enforcement mechanism. But at the end of the day, they ought to be fabric and parcel of that community.
Well, how did we get off of now? Okay, Harry's gone.
Yes.
Okay, and we miss him. I'll be right up front with you. We miss him quite a bit. So what happened here? What happened to community policing in Portland, Oregon?
You know what?
I mean, all of Portland. This is not a black and white issue.
No, it's a community issue.
It's not just a black issue, right?
No, it's a black and white issue. It's a community issue.
Right, okay.
It's a labor issue.
Okay.
It's a policy issue.
What happened?
Bruce, just like I can't give you the winning Powerball numbers, I can't give you the answer to that question either.
Okay.
On the outside looking in, as a private citizen, and I have to say this, on the outside looking in, and Mr. Mayor and city council members, I hope you're all watching and listening. On the outside looking in, I see a lack of commitment from the city and from the Bureau to community policing. And there was a time, and like I said, I've worked 36 years, there was a time when I used to see police officers, like as I said earlier, that would be at Goring Street Market, that would be at Knott Street Community Center, knew these kids by names, and they didn't interact with the kids when there were problems. For example, Charles Bedford at his store, Goring Street Market, every summer, at the end of the summer, they would have a back-to-school hot dog feed, hamburger feed, passing out school equipment, Nike shoes, backpacks, pencils, and papers. And that was done with Charles Bedford's family and Zion Methodist Church. Hmm. But the police department were there. Roy Pittman, he runs a great wrestling program.
Yeah,
you had people there that were committed to children and committed to the community. They were there. So when those kids saw those police officers flipping hamburgers and hot dogs, there was a family component there. And I don't see that. And I'm not saying it's not happening.
But then they had police, police athletic league at the time. They did have that. And I do remember some of the folks that were there during that particular time. But all of a sudden, it's not there anymore.
Well, I see the building up there. I thought it was still there. It's been a while since I've been over. Is it gone?
It's not there anymore. And you ask yourself the question, what happened to the PAL? That was a good piece. You got the Boys and Girls Club thing right across the street from the police. That was the whole idea. And all due respect, I was sitting on the board at the time, Boys and Girls Club, and suggested we have it on MLK. Okay,
I have to share that with
then
you.
The Blazers we named it the Blazers, but I don't see any Blazers coming.
When I was a student at Reed College, I actually was program director for Soulwood Boys Club.
Okay,
and I love saying that, and I am proud to say I was the first director to let girls in the facility. And because we were the smallest of the three boys clubs, I used to get grief about having girls in the boys club.
Yeah.
But because 50% of my budget was federal dollars, mm-hmm. and I had females that needed services, they got services. So every time I see the girls and boys and girls club, I just kind of laugh.
That was awesome.
It just makes me smile.
I might mention the fact you might have known him, but Chuck McCullen, does that ring a bell?
Yes, it does.
Yeah, Chuck was a dear friend of mine, former Marine type kind of a guy. And we would hang out quite a bit, and he got me very much involved with the Boys and Girls Club. And again, but he loved doing that. He was working for PGE, Portland General Electric, but he had a passion. He really liked working for Boys and Girls Club, and he got everybody involved. And as a result of that, he was the guy that actually placed Boys and Girls Club on Martin Luther King Jr. Boulevard.
Yes.
They would have kept it in North Portland.
Well, yes.
You understand what I'm saying?
Well, you know, and the need, I mean, they closed down Columbia Boys Club, which they put another when they built New Columbia, which I won't even go there because I used to work for the Housing Authority of Portland too. But we'll talk about that maybe another time. But I mean, you can never have enough facilities for children.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, the children are our future.
Yeah.
And I tell my kids, I would not trade places with this generation for all the money in the world.
Okay.
I mean, they have it so much harder. The choices that they have to make compared to what you and I had to make growing up, astronomical. Okay. And it's rough. Okay. It's rough.
Well, look, tell you what, let's get back on police, because a lot of these guys I'm sure are seeing. I mean, you know, it's like anything else.
Sure.
They've been doing all stuff on Facebook and everything else to try to see if they can get folks to rally around them, so to speak, and respond to the hard work that they're doing and the danger that it is. It's a very dangerous job. But the bottom line is that, what about solutions? What can we talk about? So union organization aspect of it. The shooting thing is always a major deal, whether it be mental health or whatever. But what can we do to share, to see whether or not we might be able to put something on the table that they can work with, maintain their unionism, maintain all the concerns that you were having from the standpoint, this, that, and the other, and contracts and buildings and that. But what can we throw on the table?
First word that comes to mind, transparency.
Transparency.
Okay, transparency.
Okay.
That has to be paramount.
Okay.
And obviously, we have issues with transparency based on the number of folks that are in the streets. As far as the union and the police component is concerned, police officers are no different than UPS drivers or anybody else that has a job.
Yeah.
There are good police officers and there are bad police officers. Mm-hmm. There are good workers and there are bad workers. Mm-hmm. A union is set in place to protect its members, but the bottom line is, at the end of the day, if you're a bad employee, not even a union can save you. And this holds true of the police bureau. Daryl Turner, who's president of the police officers, his job is to protect his members. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm going to be straightforward with you on how I feel about situation with shootings and what ought to be done. In my opinion, the way the laws are written, you're never going to have a police officer charged with the homicide.
Right.
That being said, there needs to be another component. After you have the grand jury investigation and they come back with the finding, and once that finding, once the officer is exonerated, there needs to be another piece, and I would strongly suggest, and I know some of you up here getting upset because you feel like I'm bad-mouthing the police.
Oh, no.
Actually, I'm talking about doing solutions.
What can we do?
There needs to be another component. And the other component is, after the grand jury investigation, mm-hmm. when it comes to shooting, there needs to be another investigation. Not another investigation, but another determination. The investigation has been made.
Okay.
The evidence has been put together.
Mm-hmm.
The decision has been made. You need to take all those pieces, and one final question ought to be asked. And it ought to be asked in this last case that we have. Was the shooting necessary?
Was it necessary?
Was it necessary? Was it justifiable? Was it avoidable or was it unavoidable?
Hmm.
I.e., did the officer or the participants involved, did he or she do everything that they could to defuse the situation?
Mm-hmm.
When you take a life,
mm-hmm.
that is the last thing that ought to do. Now, in my experience with officers that I know, every officer that I know has told me that the best way to defuse a situation is through distance, okay? Distance, separation, and dialogue, and communication, okay? So I think that component, was it avoidable or unavoidable? That is used with professional drivers, it's used with UPS drivers, anybody that has a CDL license and that works for a company. If you're involved in a traffic accident, you may be legally right and, you know, not charged with anything, i.e. no ticket, but in most contracts or in a lot of contracts, there's another component. Was that accident avoidable or unavoidable?
Mm-hmm.
And in some contracts, you get three unavoidable accidents, you could possibly lose your employment. I think we need to take those same pieces and tools and apply that to the police bureau. When you have situations of excessive force, when you have situations where a life is taken, the question ought to be asked, was it avoidable or unavoidable?
Mm-hmm.
You got to ask those questions.
But they can't go through, you said about three times, but you can't go through three killings or something.
No.
Okay,
no, I'm not saying that.
Okay.
To me, one killing is one killing too
much.
No, one killing too many.
Yes, right.
And Portland seems to, you know, for some reason or another, and I'm not trying to point fingers mm-hmm. or condemn, but as a community and as the police department, all the politicians, one killing is one killing too many.
Mm-hmm.
And as opposed to pointing fingers, we need to figure out how do we avoid this from happening again. The
mm-hmm.
one thing that truly troubles me, every time there's a shooting or killing in this town, the first thing that happens, the media, different elements, they want to point at the behavior of the person that got shot,
mm-hmm.
i.e. the person that got shot. That was his or her fault. No, stop doing that. The question ought to be, why did this happen? It shouldn't have happened. And
mm-hmm.
what can we do as a community
mm-hmm.
to make sure and ensure that it doesn't happen? Because it should never, ever happen. And
do you think in your mind the mayor should react immediately to make a point to the citizen as a whole?
The mayor is supposed to be the cheerleader,
right.
and he is supposed to be the person that brings all different factions and
mm-hmm.
diverse opinions
mm-hmm.
to the table and come up with solutions.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He needs to ask the question, address the question. And you know, I gotta not laugh at it, but I gotta point out, it seems like, other than being an NBA coach or a basketball coach, if you're a police chief in Portland, you're not going to have a job for long.
Right.
And the mayor needs to just a question. You know, we have a leadership problem.
Mm-hmm.
I personally feel that the way that you build a bureau is not from the top down, but from the bottom up.
Mm-hmm.
With inside the bureau, we got a culture that probably embraces community policing.
Mm-hmm.
We have a culture that loves the us versus them mentality,
mm-hmm.
and it's not working. I would say to my brothers and sisters in blue, just as you tell us in the community, when you see something wrong, say something, do something. That applies even more so within the culture of policing.
Mm-hmm.
When you see something, you need to say something, do something and address it. When you see dysfunctional behavior, because police officers get together like everybody
else.
Like
human, yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
that should be no different.
Yeah.
And what the mayor needs to do and ought to be doing, and I'm hopefully he's doing it behind the scenes, all these elements out here that seem to be in conflict, Black Lives Matter, they all need to be at the table.
Yeah.
And we need to figure out our goal should be this, not point fingers, not point blame. The goal needs to be, okay, we don't agree on everything, but we do agree on one thing. The killing has to stop.
Right.
So what can we do to ensure that it doesn't stop? And that's what the mayor needs to do. Bring all those different factions together, have them sit at the table, and bring them together.
And you think, making that kind of a statement, you think then the people would kind of rally around him, so to speak? Because he was elected, right, by the people. A government of the people, by the people, for the people, right?
One thing I never do, I never try to judge public opinion.
Okay.
It would be nice, but I would tell you this, anytime you have something unfortunate happen, you create a very emotional situation, and emotional situations can become volatile. Yeah. They can become hostile.
Yeah.
People marching on the streets, doing what they do, I'm not pointing fingers at anybody. Yeah. I tell everybody, you do what you have to do, and in the words of Frederick Douglass, continue to organize, agitate, and educate.
Yes. Right.
But the killing has to stop.
Yeah.
The dysfunctionality has to stop. Mm-hmm. It has to be addressed.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't talk about it when it happens. This needs to be a daily discussion, 24/7, 365.
Mm-hmm.
And if we don't do that, then we're all lying to ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And there'll be another funeral. There'll be another shooting.
Mm-hmm.
There'll be another officer on administrative leave. The madness has to stop.
Yeah, right. Well, you know, again, I'm talking and sharing and getting some thoughts and some ideas on this issue, because everybody's looking for that needle in the haystack.
Sure.
Everyone's looking to hit the needle in the haystack. The media's doing that thing aspect of it. All the various community leaders and the guy, and all due respect, he's out there by himself. He's like a Don Quixote. I'm talking about the mayor right now. He's really having a tough time.
Well, wait a minute. The mayor gets no sympathy for me.
I know that.
Mama used to say, you make your bed, you lie in it.
Yep, that's his
and
job.
That's what he wanted to do.
So he's got to get up with his running
shoes on.
But you know, one of the things that I did see, I noticed, and this is again my opinion, when I was running for mayor, I was pushing it. We need to districtize the city. Because you got four commissioners, they just sitting back and letting the mayor take all the heat. I mean, if they were assigned, as you say, community policing, if they were assigned in areas, let's say four different areas, blah, 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 and then the bottom line is that people would know who to go to. And then that person would have communications on an ongoing basis.
But even if you had it in the districts, we're just still chopping at the leaves, and we're not getting to the roots of the
problem. I understand, but the mayor is still totally responsible.
Right.
I'm just saying, at least there's an arm that I can go to.
Sure.
I know Howard is here.
Mm-hmm.
This is his area, and I got these blah, 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 blah routine. Another thing to think about city management, I think, what's this guy named Novak was trying to talk about that the other day.
Even if you did it, what I'm saying is, okay.
Got to get everybody to the
table. Given the system that we have and given the realities, you tell me why you can't bring people to the table now.
That's right.
Because right now what I'm seeing, for me, as a guy who's in the fourth quarter of his life, what I'm seeing right now, I'm seeing a lack of leadership in terms of bringing all the different factions together.
Got
to do that. Got to start there. And then we got to be realistic,
like
I said, about the culture with inside the Bureau, and we got to address it. We have to address it.
Well, we're trying to do everything we can here at the Oregon Voters Digest. You know what I mean? I got you at the table, you know, that's right up front. And then we got the viewing audience out there, and we're still inviting the mayor. He hasn't shown up. In fact, he hasn't even returned his call. I noticed that he made a statement, and Steve Dunn, your vote, your voice, your vote aspect of it, and said, well, he's meeting with everybody and talking to the leaders. He said that he was meeting with Matt Hennessy. I saw that, the Matt Hennessy piece. But what happened to the Minnesota Alliance? You know, what happened to Reverend Bethel and those two cats? You know what I'm saying? You understand what I'm saying?
Well, what I would say to you in this, sometimes people have to be, i.e., forced into greatness.
Yes.
I.e., so those are sleeping on his front porch when he comes out of his house, those who are occupying City Hall, by any means necessary, you got to do what you got to do.
You got to do what you have to do.
You got to do what you got to do.
Yeah. You know, Howard, this has been just great. Right up front, got to have you back on the table again. Hopefully, we'll get some feedback from the folks out there. And by the way, if you disagree with me, trust me, you can easily come here. He'd be more than glad to talk to you, right? We can get another person.
And likewise, I'd be glad to talk to him.
I understand.
And any officer in blue.
That's right. You know what I'm saying? I've been trying to get with Daryl, but we talked about that, about Daryl. I mean, his hands are pretty well tied. You know what I'm saying? You got me?
Well, his
job. We'll talk about that. Maybe we can get to Daryl again.
Well, you know what his job is? His job is he has to defend his members.
That's right.
Like I said, right, wrong, and indifferent.
That's right.
His job is to defend his members.
That's right.
You may not agree, but that's anybody that's in the union. You know what I'm talking about.
That's right. That's right. That's right. That's right. Okay. Well, Howard, thank you very, very much, brother. It's been a pleasure, and hopefully you're going to come back here on the show, would you? Would you
be my pleasure. Be my pleasure.
That. Thanks, my friend.
All right.
Okay, good. Thanks again, Howard. We're going to be right back, folks, with our second part of the show. Okay? Take care.
You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these dates and times. Tell a friend.
They're scheduled to be here on the 16th.
Oh, okay. So I'm here today.
All right. Look like I'm here, folks. We're back. We're back here at the Oregon Voters Digest. Again, I'm Bruce Broussard, your host, and look like they've gotten us all pretty well squared away. And this is our second half hour. As you can see, Howard is still sitting at the table because we're talking about, again, solutions. You know, we're talking about things in the community.
Yeah.
Things are happening. I got two powerful forces here now. I got Howard. He's going to be around. And then I've got Cynthia Harris, someone I met some time ago.
Wow, 10 years now.
Wow, isn't that something? On an issue about education, the kids, the youth aspect of it. And here she was working in administration. And I didn't meet her until all of a sudden they got rid of the superintendent. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden she was assigned to Jefferson High School. She should have been the superintendent.
I get it. That's exactly correct.
In all due respect. But, you know, it's such a pleasure to have her on. I mean, here's someone that's totally committed to community, and not only just community, Portland and a number of other things. She's well educated, got good background. I don't have to say you a whole bunch of stuff. Just Google her name. You'll see all the goodies that are sitting there. And she's very active all over the place, always trying to put things together, aspect of it. I won't mention all the organizations she's aware. As far as I'm concerned, she's got an organization now. And that is the fact that she's been so visible about doing all these other things that she's now really getting out in major action. And maybe I can get her to come over here and be one of the hosts here on the show.
Oh, I would love that once or twice.
And you and Howard, both of you, as far as I'm concerned, because we are definitely in need of good leadership.
Okay.
And what I mean by that, we're talking about impartial kind of leadership. We're not just talking about the black community. We're talking about Portland community. We're talking about Oregon community aspect of it. We're lacking. And everybody's looking for that needle in the haystack, so to speak.
Yeah.
But for the problem aspect of it. And we're all here. And so hopefully the folks who may be sitting in those positions, my thought here was to throw some stuff on the table and give them some options, if you will, that they might want to consider, if you will. You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
Because we're all struggling. Because at the end of the day, and especially our age back aspect of it, I want to relax. I want to take it easy.
That's the way I'm doing it.
I can't afford to get away from the table.
There's
so many things that are happening. I can't go downtown and just walk around and just take it easy or sit down there and fish with Howard. You know, I can't do that anymore.
We should all be growing old gracefully.
Is that what it is?
I like
that. Anyway, this is the second hour of our show. And I've got, like I said, I've got Cynthia Harris here. And now, and bottom line, there's a big gathering, if you will, of folks. It's called Transforming into Power, Equipping a Community to Address the Impacts of Gun Violence. And right up front with Eugene Richard gave me a call, and he's getting some other folks involved in the process. And then when I found out that Cynthia was involved in it, then I said, well, what I'll do, we're going to do, I'm going to be doing a show on that. And so the bottom line is that they're going to be here, but I want to give them sort of an intro, because these folks are out from out of town.
Wow.
Kind of, yeah, this is going to kind of an orientation for them. So they're looking at the show and gives them some idea of what community is about. Not just, quote, the black community.
Yeah.
I'm talking about a community as a whole, the Portland community in this particular case, but because they're going to be dealing with several counties. It's coming out the county. So Eugene Richard kind of gave me a little background.
Wow.
So this is a beautiful piece. And now
it
with
is
the,
an awesome piece.
And with these events that are happening with the shooting and this, that, and the other, it's kind of like saying in so many words, I've always maintained that a negative is more positive than a positive. It's sad to think about a life has to be given in order to get to the table to talk about these kinds of issues. But the young man, as far as I'm concerned, nobody, as far as I'm concerned, should be dying, should die in vain. Fair? You see what I'm saying?
Now, so, which young man are you speaking of?
Well, I'm talking about the just recently, the one.
There's a few, the last few years.
The one that we're talking about right now, just the recent shooting of the Hayes, the young man Hayes that was shot in the police department. We got all these divine things, and everybody's coming up, giving their interpretation of what is. You got media. I mean, maybe they're doing it for all the goods or whatever, but we need some leadership. But we kind of all have to be at the same table aspect of it. No one person pretty well runs the whole show.
Okay?
So having said that, I'd like to kind of just have Cynthia just kind of share with us. I sort of gave you a little introduction about her.
Yeah, you did.
I want her to talk to you about a little bit about what she did at Jefferson High School when she
was
there. Please spend some time on that.
Well, first of all, I don't think people really realize that the job I was heavily recruited to come to was the area superintendent.
Yes.
So that was the job I had. So I had 32 schools in the Southwest and in the North. The Northeast. And my schools in the Southwest, they loved me, but they did well. And, you know, they just needed a little nurturing. They did good. But I found like the worst school at that time. You know, that was 2006. It's been 10 years.
Wow.
And it was Jefferson High School.
Jefferson
it was lacking in so many ways. And the principal at the time was a young man out of Texas.
Yes.
And I think he could do the job, but sometimes when you come in and you're moving really fast, people want the change, but they're not ready for the change. I don't think they were ready for me either.
Right, right.
So you do what you do. And I think he was even more fast moving than me. I tend to evaluate and look, then I move fast. But then one of the things I learned, I always thought change took 3 years, but now I'm convinced it takes 10 because you don't get the roots out. You know, after 3 or 4 years, all the people are still there that are doing what they were doing that's incorrect. So I am really clear that the change has just occurred.
Yeah.
And it's
yeah.
occurring because you can see some of the long-standing problems are starting to move out the way. A lot of spotlight has been put on the school. So what I did at Jefferson was take it from the ground up. You know, there were when Vicki asked me to step in.
And she was superintendent.
She was the superintendent at the time, and she was the person, along with Barbara Adams, that brought me to this. And what I learned about myself is you have to be careful when you're invited in to do something that you have the support that you need, and you can't do it alone. You have to have the team. I think the really huge thing I learned about being pushed to the side was you have to be very clear about why you're being brought in, who are the people there that can help you, and what's been going on. So it would take a little more research than you have time to do, which is why I'm so looking forward to Miss Dr. Dickey. But, you know, I'm just wondering, you know, will he run into some of the same kinds of problems? But I think the times are different now.
I got to break you off at this point in time because I'm going to say this to you. And I'll tell you, this is why I really attached myself to you. You loved what you were doing.
I love
she
it now.
She loved what she was
because
doing.
You
she
know,
loves it now. That's
yeah, I love
why
it
she's
now.
Sitting here right now.
Right.
Talking to her.
Because here's the thing. I didn't stop because I got pushed
that's
to
right.
the side. I just
that.
Continued on
right
with
here.
The negotiations. I wanted to see exactly what they were talking about. Oh. So that problem took 3 years. And I think what they're hoping is you'll go away. And most people do. But when you get to the end and you see it's like, oh, you were disorganized. It took you 3 years to find out somebody was disorganized. But a lot of those things they talked about, other people had those responsibilities. But what I have to say for myself, I was told I'd be protected, but I wasn't. So I've learned that you have to, if you know you're in charge of something, just go ahead and be in charge of it.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
don't think somebody else is
going
to protect you. You just do it.
Yeah, do it.
And so I think that for me, it was a huge lesson. I think I'm still in the process. I'm just kind of getting out of it. I mentored a lot of those kids even after I left. Some of them have gone on with master's degrees, doctorates pretty soon. Yeah. A lot of the boys have been on large basketball. One of the first things I did was talking to the parents. I brought in my secretary from California. We talked to every parent at the school. Yes. And what we learned were many of the processes were out of whack. There wasn't a lot of evaluations. There weren't very little portfolio assessment, and not a lot of focus on the test scores. And the filth at the school was astronomical. So we did a lot of cleanup days. And Connie Van Brunn, I never will forget her. She gave me $30,000 from the Portland Foundation to come in and clean up the gym. And then the Blazers got invited, and Nike got involved. Just so much involvement.
Remember the golfing?
I was also able to get some money that had been sent back to the federal government because I had a lot of experience with magnet schools. And so we brought back $150,000 back to the school that had been sent from the district. So a lot of assessment on how money was spent and who. And at that time, they had a business person who didn't report to me, but she reported over my head. So there are a lot of misfunctionalities.
I never
saw a school district that runs like the Portland schools because they run and negotiate at the central office for what's happening at the school. No school district runs like that. So you have a principal who's a figurehead more than a leader. So I think that's a critical area that nobody talks about. So the person who is really missing the piece would be the superintendent. And it was appropriate to move Carol out because she is responsible if that's the way you're going to run it. You can't hide after you do that.
Right.
If you're negotiating $50,000 or $500,000 over here and I'm the principal, how can you do that and not be responsible for it? So that's a critical piece. So I really did focus on the students. I think the first year we had the area director had a focus on some of the students, and a lot of those students became very, very successful. When I look at the joy of the students, I think it was really worth it, you know, and the partnerships we had with PCC and the involvement of the teachers. Many, many things other people had said, because I read all the research. But the real action is when you get in the building, meeting the road. Now, to this day, I think a critical change was when Tom Potter put his office in Jefferson High School.
I will never forget that.
It totally empowered the school. He came to the school.
Yes, he did.
And he put his office in there, I believe, for three or four weeks, and he had City Hall meeting there.
Yep.
And I didn't stop the kids. It was a political move on my part, but I let them say anything they want to say. And I think it changed the school forever, and the school became very, it was a focus, a highlight. And I would say
But it didn't continue.
But it continued to a point because he kept going. And you remember he left.
Very committed.
He was very committed. And even to this day.
His wife had been a teacher. Karen is awesome. Oh, yeah. She had been a teacher at Jefferson. Yes.
And when he put his office in the school, unbeknownst to him, they put him in her office.
Oh, yes.
In her classroom.
Oh, yes.
And so I will always say, I will never forget Tom Potter.
He had a passion.
I know a lot of times when the transition takes with leadership, they try to forget what happened. But you can never forget what happened in 2006. And you can never forget Vicki Phillips because she was the transition superintendent to me.
That's why I say 10 years. What happened to that?
I think she saw, when she was making her change, that she needed to go. I saw I needed to go too, but I wanted to stay.
You stayed.
I wanted to stay and drill in for a few more months.
I might add too, she can go on because she's got so many accolades and so many whatever. But I remember the first time I met you, and I was looking for guest show, remember that?
Oh, guest, okay, that's what you're looking for.
And then I got on here and I saw that passion and all that enthusiasm. And to give you an example of that, When Norma opened up Norma's Kitchen, a business aspect of it, all of a sudden she's quick. She attached herself, and then all of a sudden she's taking her students and leadership to various businesses in the community, to black businesses, just to let people know that they exist, and had a diverse group of folks.
Yeah, and we brought the clergy out to Norma's every month.
It was just an awesome situation. And then another example of what she was doing was that she knew how passionate I was about voc ed. All of a sudden, she just stopped what she was doing. And the next thing you know, we're sitting down there at the Labors. Was it Eugene?
Corvallis.
And she got involved with that deal. And in fact, Steve Buell was with us, wasn't he? Steve Buell was with us at that point.
That was
in time.
A great day, wasn't
that
it?
That was a great day, and we were really getting things going. But they were so busy, and then we couldn't bring the rest of the folks to the table. Yes. I mean, we couldn't get the other board members to understand where she was. In all due respect, I can say that today, they weren't as passionate. See, they
well,
just
I think
wanted,
that's what I learned. Yeah, I think I learned that. You have to really find ways
yeah,
to enroll
you love what you're
people.
Doing.
Yeah,
absolutely.
You have to
love. You can see that in a person. If you don't love what you're doing, I can see straight through it. You
oh.
know what I mean, I
have to be careful
because,
with him.
Because,
huh?
all, yeah, because in all due respect, I wouldn't be here today if I didn't like what I was doing.
But you know,
I'd
that's a wonderful point that you
yeah.
raise is
having
the joy
point.
In your soul
yes.
and what you
yes.
do. Because remember, I was taken off the payroll.
Yes.
In May of 2010.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh,
so
yeah.
I even was homeless for
yes.
a while,
yes.
like about
wow.
6 months.
Yes.
And then I decided I didn't want to work like that because part of that process was finishing it.
Yes.
Okay. So then I took little jobs and I continued to work with some of the students.
Yes.
I continued to work on boards.
Yes.
And I, for myself, I go to city clubs. You
right.
know, that's where I listen to the mayor
right.
and
right.
stuff
right.
like that.
Right.
And
right.
then I worked with Dress for Success. They were very helpful in my transition.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm on the council now, and I feel like my time is almost up
mm-hmm.
there. And
mm-hmm.
what I'd like to do now...
What do you want to do?
Is just...
Once you get back in the streets.
No.
Huh?
What I want to do is continue to work
this?
On policy and continue to raise money for schools and to have a
I
multi-million dollar...
I got...
business that
I,
works.
I got one for you. I,
okay.
I got a job for you. You don't realize it.
No, that,
that's
I
didn't
realize
reason.
That.
That's another reason.
That's why I'm on the show
that's
today.
Why you're on the show today. I got a job for you, boy. And
it doesn't pay money.
It does.
Oh, okay.
And you'll find it, and
so
you're gonna
I'll
like,
just,
and you're gonna like doing
to that.
It.
I'm gonna wait. I need
I
some money.
I like doing it because I know who you are.
I need okay? some money, so let me listen
important.
To that.
So
but I do want to say one more thing.
Yeah, going on
about before we go there, is. A change can be made. I think a lot of times people think the change can not be made.
Right.
But the change can.
Yes.
And I think that everybody is upset. But I think the change was made
mm-hmm.
when Mr. Dickey was selected. And I tell you why. Because there was a boys' school and there was a girls' school. And
mm-hmm.
we knew. I mean, I've known for my whole career that the boys are in trouble, African American.
Yes,
so
right.
I think when they select a role model like this, Mr. Dickey, I'd say the change was made.
But you know,
I would say the change was
yeah,
made.
I'm glad you brought that issue up. But in all due respect, what I saw about him and what was being presented to me about it, the guy just didn't have the background. He was just playing musical chairs.
Who's that?
The guy that was just
the one that's coming.
The one that's coming.
Well, you know, that's okay because
okay.
it's
yeah,
the
share
right.
That with the people.
Okay, I'm going to share with how I see it. How I see it is a little different. I think I'm a person who grinds. Like I was a teacher and
yeah.
I've had four principalships, right? I had some in California and here. So
dream.
I really am a person who likes to build that way.
Mm-hmm.
But I think when a change is being made, there's some people that are gonna be eagles. And you have to be all right with that because the groundwork has been laid, the processes are in place.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't want that person to be like me. You want that person to fly
mm-hmm.
and to make those changes as fast as he can. And you want him to go.
You feel he has that passion?
I feel like
have
he has
had
it.
The opportunity to chat
I've
with
never
him?
Really, I've tweeted a little bit with him.
Okay.
But I've read a lot about him
okay.
and I've looked at a lot of the classroom work that he has done.
Okay.
And I think he's all right. I
okay.
think that.
Okay.
And here's the other reason I think he's okay. And I'm excited about it because the community itself selected them. You know, like sometimes when you facilitate it or you kind of like cheat, it's not perfect and you might bring the right person, but that person doesn't have the background and the
mm-hmm.
support.
Mm-hmm.
But when the process works and you get close to what you want, I think it's all right.
Well, you know, I'll be right up front with you. Well, you are more of an articulate, a little more articulate than Steve Buell. See, Steve could not. He couldn't deal with my questioning.
Well, first of all, Steve is not
Steve's
Cynthia.
A good friend of mine.
I'm a unique person.
I know that.
And I'm unique in this way. I grew in the community.
Mm-hmm.
I'm from the community.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I was elevated by yeah. community people.
Yeah, yeah.
So when you're elevated like that, it's different from being elevated by the administrator. I'm from the people.
But he's a good board member. Don't get me wrong. Now.
He is a good board member.
I know Steve
but I'm
well.
From the I'm from you. I'm
but,
from
but
the community.
I'm,
yes,
that's
I'm
community.
Different.
That's
I'm
a
from
very,
that.
Very important.
And that's a very important
yes,
point
yes,
to
yes,
to
yes.
articulate because it means I didn't go to private school. I went to public school.
Yes.
I went to junior college, and then I just worked my way
yeah.
up in every
yeah.
part of my life.
Yeah.
I come from working class,
yes.
common people. My dad
yes.
was a carpenter.
Yes.
My mother was a nurse's
yes.
aide, and they had five children. You know, so I'm normal. I was in a church. My dad. dad was head of a deacon board. I'm just normal, person who made it to the top of the mountain and got kicked off the mountain, but stayed in that arena. Yeah. So I think that's a little bit different, and I think that's why I had so much care for the kids, almost too much care.
Oh, you were right there. I mean, and I'm thinking about if that kid had come from within the Portland Public School, because the kid did graduate, you would have just jumped all on top of that situation.
Well, that's true, because remember, we had a girl that had moved out to Gresham.
Yes.
And we raised money for that child.
Yep,
we took
that.
Food to the home. We did everything. And then got accused of stealing.
I mean,
it's so hilarious. I said, you know what? I feel so much for the community people, because they don't always know how to receive the love.
They want to
complain. But let me just say one more thing about the shootings. I believe that we are responsible as a community, and that's why you're here and that's why I'm here, because we know if there's enough love in the space, these things won't happen because there will be activities for these children.
Yeah.
So that's why I'm going to this event, and that's why I continue to be involved. I can't stop the guns.
I know that.
I don't have a gun. I don't want one. I'm never going to kill anybody.
And then one thing I want to say before we get in this real quick, like, and I'm going to say this to both of you.
All right.
I'll be right up front. We're very effective. People are looking at the show.
Oh, okay? Good.
They're looking for a needle in the haystack, and a lot of people just calling people behind closed doors.
I got you.
They're calling people behind closed doors, and realistically, it's just a one-way. Just sad. Well, in most cases, some of these folks, and I'll be right up front with you, I've seen that from the mayor aspect of it. Well,
what did you see from the
lists,
mayor?
Well, he lists all the folks he's talked to. You see, keep it transparent.
Which mayor?
Mayor Wheeler right
okay,
now.
Okay, you know I'm a Wheeler woman.
But he's having a tough time. He's having a tough time. He's having a tough time. But the whole idea is this. I'm just saying, I think for his benefit, if he could just come and talk. I saw him on Steve Dean this morning, okay?
Okay.
He needs to just publicly talk right now. Let the people see him talking, not behind closed doors with these sometimes so-called leaders, because what happens a lot of times...
I have to agree
with you.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of them, they're basically knocking so-and-so. We need to be a little bit more transparent.
So how do we get the message
to him? Very simple. As far as I'm concerned, when it comes to education, you need to talk about your issues. Interview Ted. You can interview Ted right here on the show.
Absolutely.
And on the union with Daryl, okay? Daryl Turner. You can interview Daryl.
Well, you know, not a problem.
To talk about police work or whatever.
We're
union.
Yes, we need to all sing and talk together.
We got to sing all the way around, because it's going to be we all affected.
So let me just say this about why I did support Ted Wheeler.
Real quick, because I got to get this.
All right, I want to say this because I don't know who's out there listening. I didn't support him because I think, he's going to support all black people.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah.
I support him because I thought he had the ability to transition to listen across the lines. And I still believe that. I was at City Club last week when he did the State of the Union address.
Yes.
And I listened to that conversation. And I think the shaping that Ted needs is to listen to the people. He does listen to the people, but once you get in that position, sometime you begin to listen to the tarnished leader, the leader that are like the leaders who have been in place for 50 years that may be totally out of touch with the real people.
Yeah.
So I would just definitely say that as he begins to go into the community, he's going to find those real people to listen to.
Well, that's why we're doing
and
this.
And I think
this is
good.
This is truly transparent.
I would suggest to the mayor that you do one of two things.
Go ahead.
One, don't go out necessarily. I mean, talk to what people call the leadership, but show up where you're expected not to show up.
Yes,
people that you're not expected to talk to.
I love it.
You know, be that face in the crowd that when you show up and you're talking, people say, man, aren't you the mayor?
That's right.
That's what you got to do.
That's right. Like, for instance, showing up and interviewing with Bruce Broussard.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know what I mean? Publicly.
Well, you know, the point, what's your name?
Howard.
The point that Howard is making is really a good point. And that's why I don't take any whiff tickets, because I want to be that person that doesn't owe anybody.
Awesome. Right. Same boat.
Okay, all right. All right, go.
At one point in time, I was kind of like taking it back again, because he wasn't in the Marine Corps like I was. See, but you know, now I understand.
Well, I know you got your jarhead thing.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I got that jarhead thing.
What's a jarhead?
Marine type.
Oh.
See what I'm saying? But anyway, he was never in the military. But anyway, long and short of it all.
I wasn't either.
Yeah, I got you. Well, that's why I got you.
They have a fraternity that's unique only to them.
Only to them. Okay.
I recruited
interviewed both of you guys, so you guys are my race. I'm taking you through boot camp, see? Okay.
I know. Look, I've been in boot camp.
We got about 6 minutes or
okay,
so.
Okay, all right.
Why don't you tell us about this?
Okay, so
I'm a member
of the GAIN Task Force, which is now a collaborative.
Yep.
And one of the new deans of OSU came to us, and they are putting this together because they want to impact the community. And it's called Transforming Pain into Power, Equipping a Community to Address the Impact of Gun Violence.
Okay.
And I think there's a lot of stuff under gun violence, but I'm not going to talk about that. It's going to be Saturday, April the 22nd, 10 a.m. to 3, and they're putting bus loads of people. They want to fill up Highland Christian Church, which is my former church.
Yes. Okay.
And that's at 7600 Northeast Gleason, and that's Pastor Hardy. That's his church.
Oh, yeah.
And you can hashtag StandTogetherPDX. You can also go on ohsu.edu/standtogether to sign up, or you can just come. And I'm excited about it because I think there to have something that's unifying.
Good.
To have OSU come to the community. They came down. Usually you have to go up, but they came down to the community. They really want this to be successful, and I think we can demand other programs about other health issues. I think gun violence is one issue, but I think the heart of the issue is love.
Yes.
You know, how people love each other, because if you really love somebody, you can't shoot them.
Yes, that's right, that's right, that's right.
You know what I mean? So I think we're gonna get to the other real issues, the heart issues, and how people relate and treat each other. We're gonna get to that.
Good, good, good. Well, I want you to show you an idea about us getting together.
Sure.
Eugene Richard called me about this
issue. Good friend of mine.
You got me?
Yes.
And he told me about how this was going to happen. And then naturally, I called her.
Right.
And then all of a sudden, she's
involved
in the process.
Can I announce this?
You got my point? Yes, it sounds great. So by the way, there's going to be some of the top speakers are going to be on the show on the 16th.
Beautiful.
Okay.
They're going to be on the 16th.
Okay.
The 16th. So we're going to do a show again on that piece aspect of it. And that'll be good. So we're really
encouraging. Is there any way you could stream it on the 16th?
We're going to do the whole thing. In fact, I'm going to try to see if I can get PCM to actually do a video of the whole piece of everything if we can. Okay, well then this has been just great.
I'm excited about it. It's really cool.
I mean, just to be here with some now got me giving me a little bit more enthusiasm now.
Now I got
to tell Norma it's okay for Bruce to come over here and do this as opposed kind of share his time between the vets and some community stuff.
Yeah, this is yes.
Okay. All right, good.
And this is going to be so excellent. And the more you can talk about that, it helps OSH you.
Well, thank you very much.
All right,
appreciate that very much, Howard.
Thank you.
Always a pleasure. I'll be seeing you guys again, right?
Yes.
You guys.
Thank you so much. And I want to acknowledge you. You know, like during my transition and things I've done, you've always been there. And I want to just say thank you. You've been there too.
You're here. Thanks for staying here.
Okay. Thank you,
folks. Take care and thank you very much. This has been an excellent show. I'll see you next week. We're going to have kind of a debate kind of a deal. This is going to be a very interesting show.
Should be good.
A very interesting debate. Okay, fine. Take care. I'll see you next week. Take care. Happy Easter, too, by the way, to everybody.
When is Easter?
A couple weeks.
You can see I don't go to church.
Always tell that age factor right up
there. When is Easter?